Hallelujah. You know, when I was looking up here, looking at the stars, you know, the astronauts and all those who study galaxy, they say, at a time a human being can see around 2,000 stars if you look in the sky. But there are thousands, billions of stars existing in galaxy. How awesome our God is, isn't it? How awesome our God is. Are you ready to trust in Him? Amen? Are you ready to trust in Him? And today we are going to learn something amazing which I had been teaching Daniel, our son Daniel. He has finished working for more than a month and he got his salary. And I remembered my parents talking to me. You know, my dad told me that I should never forget to tithe. I must give 10% to the Lord. And he told me, if I eat that 10%, I will not have seed for my next income to come in. And this is what he shared, and I remembered all my life, and I never, by God's grace, the glory goes only to my King, that I never missed to tithe him. And today when, these days, I was talking to Daniel. And I was telling him, Danny, my dad taught me to tithe 10%. But I want to tell you something. You know, the entire salary of yours belongs to God. It's not 10%. The whole salary belongs to God. And I want you not to stick with the figure of 10%. Move beyond that. Move beyond that. And be a good steward of what God has given you. And I'm so glad that he said, Mama, I'll always do that. And then I thought, why don't I also share it with my spiritual children today here? Even as you have gathered the scriptures that talk about what God has for us. And please turn with me to Nehemiah chapter 5. 140 years the walls were broken. There was poverty around. Nehemiah was the person who saw this. Now let me tell you, 140 years, many people must have crossed these walls. But they never thought of building it. And I admire this man. Because he sees it and he can't bear it. And his heart and mind is completely forced to channelize in building that wall. And today we are going to look at how Nehemiah confronts problems. Now, I do not know whether you have heard this message, but the scriptures were super. I enjoyed studying it. And this is what I really admire this man. What a heart and what a difference that he made. I'm reading from Nehemiah chapter 5 and verses 1 to 12. Now the men and their wives raised a great outcry against their fellow Jews. Okay? Now listen and read the scriptures very carefully. Because the word of God will open your eyes today. And it says here, second verse I'm reading. Some were saying, we and our sons and daughters are numerous. In order for us to eat and stay alive, we must get grain. Now there is a cry of God's people who are building this wall. You know, corporate, fantastic. The walls are being built. Money is coming in. You know, you can see the walls coming up. Churches are being established in UAE, in many nations. But you see, the people of God inside, they are crying out. And this is the first group of people which we read in scripture 2. Verse 2, some were saying, we and our sons and daughters are numerous in order for us to eat and stay alive. We must get grain. Individual people were suffering. Financially, they were suffering. Now, this was the first group who was at fear and risk because they were many. Their family was big. How are we going to supply food to our family? That was their cry. And we see the second group, verse 3. Others were saying, we are mortgaging our fields, our vineyards, and our homes to get grain during the famine. You see, the second group, another group, which is escalating with another set of problems. Now, they are mortgaging their properties because they do not have food for the famine. There was a recession around, as we have faced. And we see here, let's read the third group. Verse 4. Still others were saying, we have had to borrow money to pay the king's tax on our fields and vineyards, although we are of the same flesh and blood as our fellow Jews, and though our children are as good as theirs, yet we have to subject our sons and daughters to slavery. Some of our daughters have already been enslaved, but we are powerless because our fields and our vineyards belong to others. Now the third group has borrowed from the kings. And you know what they were doing? They were taking interest. And when a person would mortgage its property, they had to even sell their children to stand as a guarantee. Now, this was the third group who was living on borrowing. Well, we might have credit cards. We might have personal loans. There are a group of people, you know, who is living on loans. You see, sometimes, you know, when we are surrounded by temptation in life, there's a very thin line where I need to stop buying. And we continue to make expenses after expenses. And this is that group who has moved beyond what their requirement was. And the income was less, expense was more. Sometimes when I also go to the mall, even I'm tempted. I say, no, Lord, it's okay. I have my two pants, it's perfectly all right. And a couple of tops, it's perfectly all right. Because I have learned it. In 2012, I had a credit card and I owed $35,000. To the bank. And I cried to the Lord, Lord, I don't want to live in debt. And I went and took advice, a financial advice, a counselor from a church. And this brother told me that I need to stop, if I want to get rid of that card, I need to stop that card to be used. First thing. Second thing, I need to start paying more than what I pay every month. I said, Lord, I'm going to do that. I'm going to do that. I don't want to see this card. On 31st night, December, I'm going to stand and tell I don't owe anyone anything. And I started working towards it. And I increased my tithes so that I would be blessed more. I want people, don't just live because we are living. We need to be smart. And I could get rid of that credit card in my life. And I want to encourage you. Even if you desire, God can give you a breakthrough. And we see here, Nehemiah says, when I heard their outcry and these charges, I was very angry. He saw the injustice. You know, I'm sure if we had to speak to God, God's heart, he must be angry on that Visa Express for the interest, for the MasterCard, the interest. I'm sure. And we see Nehemiah was angry with what was happening around. Are we angry? We cannot come out till we see that we have been fooled. You know, it's easy to pay, they say. But it becomes really uneasy, let me tell you. You get loans very easily, but it is very difficult to pay. And especially when you work out the interest that you are paying, you will always see that you have been cheated. So here we see that he was angry. Look at scripture 7. I pondered them in my mind and then accused the nobles and officials. I told them, you are charging your own people interest. So I called together a large meeting to deal with them. Very smart guy. What did he do? What did he do? He had a meeting with all those people who were charging heavy interest. But you know, before he could call the meeting, he pondered in his heart. He thought about it. Have you thought about your financial situation? Where is it leading you? Because when we borrow from someone, we are slave to that person. And he said, we are reading scripture 8. And said, as far as possible, we have brought back our fellow Jews who were sold to the Gentiles. Now you are selling your own people only for them to be sold back to us. They kept quiet because they could find nothing to say. So I continued, what you're doing is not right. Shouldn't you walk in the fear of our God to avoid the reproach of our Gentile enemies? He was speaking directly to them. You know, pastors don't preach on giving. Most of the pastors. When we visit other churches, the other church pastors tell, pastors, can you preach on giving? Because if I preach, my church would be offended. But we want to teach you the truth. Because you will walk in the light of the scriptures alone. Amen? And you will be called the blessed. And the scripture says that he had a meeting with them. And verse 10. Read it carefully. I and my brothers and my men are also lending the people money and grain. What does that mean? What does that mean? Nehemiah himself was doing the same thing. But he had the courage to confess it. He had the courage to accept that he was doing the same thing. And we see here, wonderfully, it has been quoted here. But let us stop charging interest. See? That is fruit of repentance. Stop it. Give back to them immediately their fields, vineyards, olive groves, and houses, and also the interest you are charging them. 1% of the money, grain, new wine, and olive oil. You know? 1%. That means annually they were charging 12% interest. Plus they were keeping their children as slaves. So they say here, we will give it back. They said, and we will not demand anything from them. We will do as you say. Then I summoned the priest and made the nobles and officials to take an oath to do what they had promised. Now in this scripture, Nehemiah has introduced us to the culture. The famine, the problems, the financial crisis that people were facing. And today, if you compare it, it's the same thing. There's no change in it. And we also learn here that even Nehemiah, when he came to know that he was doing wrong, he amended his ways. Can we do that? Whatever that we learn today, can we ask God, Lord, forgive me. I'm going to change my ways. I'm going to live differently. You know, people say that I am not rich. If you have a tap in your house, you know what's a tap? Water tap. You are rich. You are not walking miles to bring water. God has provided us living in Dubai. God has blessed us. But still we find that we are in certain traps of our life. And these are the traps that God wants us to come across, to know about it and change our ways. Let's be angry like Nehemiah. You know, some people worship money, but we need to worship God with our money. Amen? Amen? The love of money is the root of all evil. If we are greedy for it, then we are definitely going to fall in trap. And as I was talking to Daniel, I told him, Daniel, that money doesn't belong to you. You are a steward. Your salary that God has blessed you, it completely belongs to King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. I wish my dad would have told me this years back. I would have been more, you know, used godly wisdom to work my ways out. So we see here, the second thing that I was studying and I want you to also go through it is God is faithful and he can be completely trusted. How many of you all believe this? Hallelujah. Do you trust God? Amen. And I'm taking you to scripture. Turn your Bible quickly to Leviticus chapter 25. And we are going to read from verses 8 to 10. Awesome scripture. And you need to have a heart to believe this. Now count off 7 Sabbath years. 7 times 7 years. So that 7 Sabbath years amount to a period of 49 years. Then have the trumpet sounded everywhere on the 10th day. Consecrate the 50th year and proclaim liberty throughout the land to all its inhabitants. It shall be a jubilee for you. Each of you is to return to your family, property, and to your clan, to your own clan. You see? In biblical terms, the 49th year, they had Sabbath of land. Okay? Now, 7 years, when you cultivate that land, the 7th year, you have to take complete rest. God's people were told that they shouldn't be working on the 7th year. If you are told, do not work for 1 year, what would be our condition? Can you imagine? And you see, these people, God told them, you have to work for 6 years on the land. And on the 6th year, I will bless you with so much that it will continue to be a blessing until the 9th year. That means the 7th year and the 8th year, you're going to store it, correct? Because you have the extra from the 6th year to work till the 9th year, that means you're going to store it. So I want you to remember this, that God wanted to teach his people to revere him, to obey him. These blessings would only work if they obey God. You know, 7 years, 7 times, 49 years. One generation would learn the faithfulness of the Lord, isn't it? 49 years is enough. It's for Rosh and Daniel for them to learn how God can be faithful. And that's the need of that 49 years. And the 50th year, I was reading and I was studying on this. 50th year was the year of Jubilee. If we have sold our land or we have loaned it out, it came back to us. And I was thinking whether God's people could sell their land, because on the 50th year, it would go back to the person. Why? Because the land did not belong to his people. Land belonged to God alone. You see? They had to just take care of it. So, imagine a person is in a slavery. His land is gone. And he knows that the 50th year is just 3 years away. And the trumpet would be blown. And he will know that he has got back his land which he had lost. You know, a trumpet is going to be blown very soon. Jesus is coming. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Are we waiting? Are we waiting? Because he is going to give us what belongs to us. He died for our sins. He died so that our relationship with our Heavenly Father would be restored. And when he comes, and when the trumpet sounds, it's going to be very soon, dear brothers and sisters, we would be completely with our Heavenly King. Hallelujah. Are you excited about that trumpet sound? And these people were excited because they came back to their original position. God gave opportunities to his people. It's only when we believe what we have is his. Amen? Whatever God has given us, may it be our children, may be the property, may be the finance, may be our businesses, may be work, all belong to him. Where does my help come from? From the heaven. Is our trust in our savings, in the land that we have purchased, in the shares that we have purchased? No. Because my God shall provide all my needs from the riches of his glory. Philippians 4:19 says that. Hallelujah. I don't have to beg anyone, because my King and my God himself is able. God is able. Can we trust God with our finances, with our children, with everything that belongs to us? It doesn't belong to us. It only belongs to the Heavenly King. Hallelujah. Jesus talked about money. 39 parables that Jesus spoke, out of that, 11 parables speaks about money. If you read Gospel Luke, you will see after every 7 scripture, 1 scripture talks about money. 800 times money is used, the word money is used in Bible. Hallelujah. He preached about it. He preached about love. He preached about the kingdom of God. And he also preached about money. And that must be surely one of the reasons that we should know how to be a good steward of our money that he has trusted us. Let me take you to John chapter 6 and verses 5 and 6. This is a fantastic story, which all of us have learned it from our junior church. But let's read it. Sometime after this, let's read from scripture 1. Jesus crossed to the far shore of the Sea of Galilee. that is the Sea of Tiberias. And a great crowd of people followed him because they saw the signs he had performed by healing the sick. Then Jesus went up on a mountainside and sat down with his disciples. The Jewish Passover festival was near. When Jesus looked up and saw a great crowd coming towards him, look at this. He said to Philip, "Where shall we buy bread for these people to eat?" And sixth scripture, he asked this only to test him, for he already had in mind what he was going to do. Now there was a crowd of 5,000 people, and Jesus wanted to feed them. You know, I really love Jesus because he takes care of us fully, physically, emotionally, spiritually, in every way. Even if it's KFC or whatsoever, he gives the best. It's good to hang around with Jesus because you will never lack anything. Amen? He takes care of you. And he is asking Philip, "Philip, what are you going to do about this situation?" Now, they have a major problem. They have not only a problem of bread, bakery, transportation, time, isn't it? Very difficult. How are they going to provide this crowd? And Jesus is asking Philip, "What are you going to do?" Jesus is asking you today. You might have problems in your life. You have a rent check to pay. You have your children's schools reopening. You have to pay the fees. You know, you have a problem which you yourself know what you are in. You know, you cannot even share it with anyone. Such problems. But let me tell you, Jesus is interested in our problem. He asked Philip, "What are you going to do about this?" In the next scripture, it is written, he knew what he's going to do. But he asked Philip. Jesus knows the solution of the problem that is existing in our lives. But at that situation, what is our response? When Jesus will ask us, "Neeta, what are you going to do with this problem of yours? How are you going to solve it?" And we see here, Philip is an analyst, you know. He tells him, "Even if you give them a bite, we'll need half years of salaries," you know. We sometimes have an analysis of our financial, we have it in the Excel document. You know, after 3 months this, after 6 months this, after 1 year this. We try and do all those things, isn't it? I can see some smiles there. And he comes with the same analysis and he says, "No, we can't. Because when heaven is there to help us in the problem that we are facing, things around doesn't matter. It doesn't work. Let me tell you, you will be always faced with challenging situation in your life. You cannot run away. God's people are still facing it now at this time also. Why? Because they need to learn to love God. Because they need to trust in Him. If you read Deuteronomy, God talks about bringing the whole tithe. Now, why God is talking about tithes? Because he wants to teach his people to revere him, to honor him. And when we worship him, when we give unto him what belongs to him, we revere him, we honor him. There has been an analysis made. And you know, people, only Christians only tithe, not tithe, they give to the Lord 3%. 97% is in their pocket. And that's why their pockets are with holes. You are not the owner of your money. God has given it. We need to be a good steward of money. Do you think Judas was interested in those 30 silver coins? He threw it. The thing which he loved. You think all those people did not know Jesus? Do you think those Pharisees and Sadducees needed Judas? No. They knew who is Jesus. Even Jesus said, when I was teaching there in your synagogue, you never came, and now you have come with weapons to catch me. It was Satan who wanted to use Judas. You know, Satan comes and tells us lies. Big time lies. I'm sure he must have told Judas. He could, you know, God could not keep us up there. We fell down. Lucifer must have said, we fell down. See? Even his disciples are going to fall down. Now you see, Satan was also after Peter. Didn't Jesus say this? Careful, Peter. Satan is going to sift you. But I'll pray for you. Satan is having very few years, very less time with him. And he's frustrated. He wants to catch as many as he can. And finance is a very good lucrative way to put people down. And we see the same thing happen. Judas died before Jesus could be crucified. He threw that money. He did not use that money. What are we learning today? We are learning. In the last days, the word of God says that people would be lovers of. People would be lovers of money. Themselves. When we think about ourselves, then we think about the gadgets, we think about, all those things that I needed. You know how we express our love? I'll tell you. The person whom you love the most, you'll buy the most costliest gift, isn't it? Isn't it? That's because our mind is not on the mind what God has for us. We are only good steward of our money. God is going to take an account. You know, we all make mistakes. I made mistakes. I shared with you. And I cried to the Lord. And he heard me. And I'm telling you, this is a deeper cry of my heart. Even as Nehemiah looked, the walls were coming up. Corporately, they were very successful. The enemies was afraid. But you see, individual people in his camp who was working with him were suffering with financial problems. And he was angry. He was angry. I'm sure when God looks at our situation, he himself is angry, not with us, with how the situation has taken us to another level. Let's be wise. Let's ask the Holy Spirit to help us. Today I'm going to pray that God will give us a breakthrough in our finances. That we will not only give to him, we will also save him, save money. We will also, you know, I want to tell you about Joseph. Joseph was very wise. He saved for the crisis that was coming. If we give to the Lord what belongs to Him, if we worship Him, if we revere Him, then you see, things will change in our lives. And this was what I taught my son today. As I was talking to him again, I told him, "You have to be wise, my son. You have to be wise." I wish I would have known these scriptures many years back so that I would have lived wisely. But today, you have heard it. Talk to your children. Teach them to budget. Teach them to give to the Lord. We always tell our children, whenever anyone gives you anything, what belongs to the Lord, give it to the Lord. Teach your children and you will see your generation would be blessed. The last trumpet is going to be blown. Are we ready? Hallelujah. Let's be moving in the ways of the Lord all the time. And I want to encourage you today, if you find yourself in bondage, any financial bondage, I'm going to pray. I want you to trust the Lord as God's people trusted Him. 1 year, no work. But God gave them enough for 3 years. Not 1 year, 3 years. Sixth year, He gave them for until ninth year what they could produce. And they didn't have to do anything 1 year. They rested. You know, God also worked. What does Bible says? Genesis chapter 1 and 1 verse. He created, He worked, and He rested. God also wants us to rest in the areas of finances. When we trust in Him, we will see a mighty breakthrough in our lives. Hallelujah. Can we all rise up today? Because we are going to pray. We have the same loving Jesus right now with us. Incredibly loving. And He is super in multiplying. Amen? Do you believe this? What did Jesus do? You see, Andrew came with a solution. He said, "Jesus, we have 5 loaves and 2 fish here." Now that sounded like stupid, silly. But we are going to do something stupid and silly. Today, ask the Lord to multiply what you have in your hand. Don't look at your needs might be huge and what you have in your hand is less. Don't look at what you have. If Andrew would have looked at that, he would never take those fish, those 2 fishes and 5 loaves to Jesus. But Jesus is expert in multiplying resources. Until we give to the Lord, it will never be multiplied. Give and it shall be given unto you. So the supernatural principle of giving exists. And that's what we are going to pray. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Lord Jesus. Praise you, Father, Lord. Praise you, Jesus. Let's all close our eyes. Hallelujah, Lord Jesus. You must have thought maybe this will work. Maybe this will solve the problem. But the solution is only with Jesus. Only Jesus can give us a breakthrough. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. You know, when Jesus took that 5 loaves and 2 fishes, He looked to the heaven and He thanked. Many a times we are so irritated with what we have. We have very little. Forget about being thankful. We are angry. with what little we have? Can we look at what we have and thank the Lord? Church, open your mouth and thank. Thank the Lord for the children God has given you. Thank the Lord for the money that God has given you. Thank Him. Open your mouth and thank the Lord. Thank you, Lord, for giving me that salary. Thank you, Lord, for giving me that job, oh Lord. Thank you, Lord, for giving me such wonderful parents, oh Lord. Thank you, Lord, for giving me such wonderful children, oh Lord. Thank the Lord. Yes. Hallelujah. Come with a heart of gratitude. Hallelujah, Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Our eyes are only open to criticize. We criticize our children. We criticize our parents. We criticize the music. We criticize pastors. We criticize our spouse. We criticize our bosses. We criticize everything. We are never satisfied. Can we change that attitude? Because when we look at those who do not have, you know, you will know to honor God. You'll know to rever Him. Can you tell the Lord, Lord, I thank you, Lord, for the job that you have given me. I thank the Lord. I thank you, Lord, for giving me such wonderful children, for giving me such wonderful parents, for giving me such wonderful business, for giving me such wonderful office, for giving me such wonderful bosses, for giving me such wonderful land to serve you, for giving me a wonderful church, oh Lord, for giving me wonderful pastors, for giving me wonderful friends, oh Lord, for giving me wonderful teachers, oh Lord. Hallelujah. Can we come with a heart of gratitude? Hallelujah. Nehemiah saw that even he did the wrong thing, and he amended his ways. If today we have realized that we have done something wrong, it's the day to change. Ask the Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit, help me, Holy Spirit. Help me, Holy Spirit. In the areas that I'm struggling, Holy Spirit, can you please help me? Hallelujah. Forgive me, Lord. Church, tell Jesus, forgive me, Jesus. Forgive me. Hallelujah, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Lord, I ask, Lord, forgive me, Lord, Father. If I had a critical heart or mind against anyone, oh Lord Jesus. Forgive me, Lord Father. If I have wronged you, Lord, by not being grateful to you, Lord Jesus. Forgive me, Lord. Lord, I pray, Lord Jesus, that today it's a new beginning in my life, Lord Jesus. Whatever you have given me, my heart is full of gratitude, oh Lord. I'm thankful. I thank you, Lord, for my husband, oh Lord. I thank you, Lord, for the church, oh Lord. I thank you, Lord, for the wonderful children, oh Lord. I thank you, Lord, for this ministry, oh Lord. I thank you for this nation, oh Lord. I thank you, Lord, for my parents, oh Lord. I thank you, Lord, for my relatives, oh Lord. I thank you, Lord, for all those who are in touch with me, Lord Jesus. Lord, I forgive, oh Lord Jesus, all those who have offended me. Right now, Lord, I ask you to forgive me. Lord, because if I don't forgive, oh Lord, how can I bring my gift to you, Lord Jesus? And how will I be blessed in my finances? Lord, I do not hold anyone against me. Lord, I speak, oh Lord, Father, forgiveness, oh Lord. Lord, I release people, those who have offended me, those who have put me in trouble, oh Lord. I release them, oh Lord. I forgive them. I bless them, oh Lord, Jesus. I bless my brother, oh Lord. I bless my sister. Church, you need to say this. Open your mouth, church, and tell, please forgive me. I forgive. Nehemiah did it. He called for the meeting and he amended his ways. He told everyone that they need to change, and they changed, and God blessed them. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And God allowed them to build that wall for His glory. And even as we amend our ways, God will raise a wall around you. You know, the word of God says Satan comes like a flood. You know, in this situation, the circumstances around us do not change, but God increases the level where we are standing. If you have built your house on the sand, the floods will destroy it. Build your house on the word of God today, as we have heard the word. We build our life around that word. We will see breakthroughs, because challenging times are coming. Be Joseph. Be wise. Be wise. Lord Jesus, we come to you, Lord. Lord, I pray, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. God's people, lift your hands up. Sing, even as the worship team sings this song, let's sing and let's worship the Lord, and we'll come back and pray. Let's just worship Him right now. Hallelujah.
You're all I want.
Yes, Lord Jesus.
And You're all I ever needed. And You're all I want. Help me know You are near. Draw me close to You.
Draw me close to You.
Even as they have spoken to you. They have declared things, O Lord. They have repented, O Lord, Father. That today, O Lord, it's a new beginning in their life, O Lord. Jesus, I speak breakthrough as a servant of Most High God. Lord, I declare breakthrough, Lord Jesus. Lord, I pray, O Lord, Father, that you will multiply those two fish and five loaves. Lord, not only their need will be sufficed, but they will have leftovers in their life, O Lord Jesus. Lord, they will have bank balances. Lord, they will have land. They will have houses. Even as they change their ways, O Lord Father. Lord, I bless them, O Lord Jesus. Fantastic relationship with their children, O Lord. With their parents, O Lord. With their employers, with their employees, O Lord. Lord, in their business, bless them, O Lord Jesus. Lord, I pray, O Lord, orders, O Lord, new deals, O Lord. Finances, O Lord, Father, in the business. Lord, increment, I declare it over them, O Lord Jesus. Lord, I pray, Lord Jesus, that you will give them promotions, O Lord. Father, we pray for signs, wonders, and miracles. Your word is live and active, O Lord Father. And today it will not come back void, but it will perform what it has been called for, O Lord, in the name of Jesus. Lord, I pray, Lord, that we will not hold anything against anyone. Lord, forgive your people, O Lord Jesus, that they will be able to look into each other's eyes and talk, O Lord Father. Every offense, O Lord, everything, every negative word, O Lord, you will erase it. You can do it, Lord. Only you can do it. Lord, we want to walk in your ways. And I bless, Lord Jesus, your people, that they would be a blessing. They would be a blessing to others, O Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord, for this word, O Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Holy Spirit, for helping, O Lord Jesus. It's only because of you that I could stand here today, O Lord. I thank you, Lord. In Jesus' most precious name, all God's people say, Amen. Thank you, church. God bless you.